Firstly, I would like to thank the International Permaculture Association for organizing me to be here. And I would like to thank also Fambi Zanai, who actually trained me into permaculture, and of course, the father of permaculture, Dr. Bill Morrison, who actually trained me as well into permaculture. And I'm proud of him, and I'm proud of myself in the work of permaculture. Yes, my talk is going to be about smallholder farmers or household farmers as permaculture nodes. And I'll go step by step showing you my ideas of what we want to create in the Eastern and Southern Africa. And with your support, I think we're going to achieve in the next few years. I'm an African, and I'm coming from Africa. That's Africa. And I'm going to talk a little bit more on this part, which is the Southern and Eastern Africa. The Southern and Eastern Africa, it consists of about 21 countries. But according to COMESA, and it has about 26 countries. The COMESA, that is led by the government countries' heads of states, and they actually run the COMESA. I'll explain a little bit about it. COMESA is called the Common Market for Eastern and Southern Africa, and it's led by president or prime ministers of the countries in the Eastern and Southern Africa. And also, the Eastern and Southern Africa is constituted by SADC, which is also Southern African Development Community. And also, it's supported by the Eastern Africa Community. And all in all, they are under the African Union, which is led by the President Robert Mugabe currently. A little bit about background in for agriculture in Africa is that, not in Africa, but in Southern Africa or in SADC. It's that agriculture production is central to the region's development, that at least 70% of the total population depends on agriculture for food, income, and employment. Systems of farming is mixed there. We have organic farming, permaculture, animal farming, number of farming activities that are there, even forestry, beekeeping, and others. The agriculture contributes about 35% to the region's gross domestic product, and 40% of the region's production, its population, live below the international poverty datum line of US$1 per day. In SADC, only 5% of all land is arable, but only 45% of this land is cultivated, and only 4% of the cultivated land is under irrigation, and this irrigation is only directed to the most privileged, the commercial farmers and monocultural farmers. According to UNICEF, about 2.4 billion people will be there in 2050. And the challenge there is the food security. Who's gonna feed these people? What system of farming do we need to employ or to put to feed these people? The system that take care of the environment whilst producing food, and I know the answer is permaculture. The majority of the population will be women, youth, and as you know, in Southern Africa, women are the leaders in farming. Women are the pillars of food security at household level. But are we giving them chance to lead us? There's a question there. For the youth, what system of education are we putting in place to encourage the youth to understand permaculture or agriculture? Mostly, we send our children for white-collar job training. It's a challenge for the future. In Africa, we have a challenge of land grabbing. In Africa, the land grab is done by corporates or international corporates, and it's sort of another colonization. And we are saying no in the word of permaculture. We also have problem of land grab within countries by politicians. They take land without proper systems, without proper channels, and this land goes in the hand of the people who are not skilled. And what shall we do? And it's usually part of the tribalism and politics that influence that. And the allocation of land, it's again, who knows who in Africa. We have a challenge. And who is suffering most is the smallholder farmer, the household. When you talk about smallholder farmer, we are encompassing mainly, we are focusing mainly on the rural areas of Africa or Southern Africa, where these people, they do not have access to most of the land that they have. It's a reserve land. What does that mean? It means the land belongs to government, and they are there temporarily there. They can be removed at any time, like what is happening in Mozambique. 4 million people are gonna be removed for the pro-savanna project to grow biofuel. For food policy by African Union and its allies favors middle-class people and industrialized food systems rather than smallholder farmer. But statistics tells me that 70% of regional food comes from smallholder farmer, but we are not supported. GMO industrial agriculture, intensive farming, monoculture farms, supported by some government, like in South Africa, 80% of the maize that is grown in South Africa is GMO. Although we have an advantage of the other Southern Eastern Africa countries, they rejected GMO. But it's penetrating again in the means of retrofication, where they are introducing nutrients into the food, and it's part of GMO processes. Land redistribution is also going to unskilled people in the name of votes. When we are towards elections, you find that the government can campaign and they promise that to give you land, and people they get so that the government will get votes in certain countries in the Eastern Southern Africa. It is known that smallholder farmers' systems are underdeveloped, but not on the agenda of African heads of state. They do not have access to running water, and they do have poor land or poor soils where they live in. Food aid to Africa created dependence to local people. You'll find that when there is disasters, you find food is being distributed in Africa, but we don't know where it is coming from. We don't know what is in the food, but what's the process? What are we trying to do? Are we teaching them how to fish, or we are giving them fish? You find that in the region, there is promotion of biofuel, where a lot of jatropha trees, plants are grown, sugarcane is grown for biofuel. We don't need biofuel, we need food. And some food are grown for dogs specifically, and some food are grown specifically to feed dairy and meat animals. And imagine the process there and the energy that we lose to get a piece of meat. Why can't we just go probably promote vegetarian in the region so that we grow food specifically for the people, not for animals? There is a challenge also on the erosion of biodiversity and cultural diversity, because even our culture, we tend to forget who we are as black people of Southern Africa. We tend to forget our culture, and we have challenges of erosion of biodiversity, of mining. When a mine comes into an area, it takes over the rights of water and then the people, they suffer, they do not have water. The natural resources desertification is happening in our area because of monocultural farming that is allowed by the governments or heads of state of Eastern and Southern Africa. Nutrition insecurity is one of the challenges that we found in the region. The region talk about food security, but when they talk about food security, what do they mean? They mean growing maize. Maize is not of our origin. It doesn't come from Africa, it comes from Mexico, Zia maize. Our indigenous crops is millet and sorghum, and that's what our staple food is. But it was diverted that we have to learn that maize is our staple food. It's not in Africa. There is a challenge also that we found in most cases in Southern Africa, environmental injustice, lack of ecological governance and systems in the policies or head of states, the government. I would like to say, as I indicated, that we thank Bill Molson for reminding us about permaculture, but permaculture has been there before Bill Molson came in Africa. I remember very well when I was young, my father used to grow different type of crops, and we never go to shops to buy food. We will get all our food within the farm, within at a household level, and the land was just less than five hectares, and all the food was coming from there. Han, mushroom, number of things were coming from. We never go to shop to buy, like what I'm doing right now. I don't go to shop to buy food. So I learned from my father. But we are lucky because Bill Molson introduced the word permaculture. We didn't know the system we were practicing, whether it's permaculture or what. But we take, that's why it was easier for me to take permaculture further. So as you know, the history of permaculture in Africa, it actually started when in 1987, when Bill Molson came in Botswana and do a permaculture PDC course in permaculture. And one of the people who attended is Bridget O'Connor, who is here. And after that, they came to Fambi Zanai, introduced it to Fambi Zanai, where I get trained in the late 80s. And then from there, permaculture started spread and introduced to organizations like RISCOP, PELAM, and other organizations in Zimbabwe. And it moves into South Africa, it moves into the region and supported by different organizations. And we have quite a great movement in Southern and Eastern Africa about permaculture. In particular in Zimbabwe, nearly all NGOs and the government institution, they learned about permaculture. But we still have a problem that we think I'll address, I'll try to explain it today. Permaculture has created jobs, business, and improved lifestyles of a number of people and influenced the policies at certain level. For example, RISCOP is working with schools and they influenced a lot on the school curriculum. And also, PELAM influenced at a number at a certain levels in Zimbabwe. And also in South Africa, we have organizations that are influencing permaculture into the government, yeah, for the community, on behalf of the community. Challenges in permaculture. We found that permaculture is not in the mainstream education, but I still acknowledge the work of RISCOP in the region, but we need to put more effort into it so that we change the face of Africa or Southern Africa. Permaculture concept is a challenge to grasp, especially at government and the academic level, because it's complex and it can put corporates out of business easy. So they tend to brush it out. They tend to, as if they don't understand it. And then, because they know, once they accept it, we take over. Permaculture sometimes is perceived as a subsistence farming. No, it's not for subsistence farming. Permaculture can be designed from subsistence to commercial. The challenge is that some permaculture institutes, they train permaculture as an organic farming. Permaculture is not organic. Organic is part of permaculture. Permaculture is broad. Agroecology, it's a tool for permaculture. But if you start teaching people the soil fertility and you say it's permaculture, no, that is just a tool. Permaculture is broader. It's everything. It's a way of life. Land tenure system, home consumption versus enterprise. Sometimes most permaculture practitioners fail to demonstrate better yield per hectare in comparison to industrial agriculture. In South Africa, I demonstrated and I challenged the Monsanto farmers. They produce 0.7 kg per square meter, whilst I produce 1.2 kg of maize per square meter on my farm. And the seeds I don't buy, I keep my own seeds. I don't use synthetic chemicals, and I don't use synthetic fertilizer and sprays or pesticides. I use my natural pesticides from plants that I grow in the farm. So, land tenure system, usually, as I indicated earlier, that you find in rural areas or smallholder farmer, they don't own 100% of that land. They do not have title deeds. And this is a movement that we need to address with the head of states. To say, if someone is occupying a land, to practice permaculture, permaculture is for life. It's a permanent system. So if it's a permanent system, I should own the land, not land belong to government. Government should organize that we get the land, it comes in our own hands, and we have title deeds. And then we can practice properly permaculture. Government agriculture allocation favors commercial farmers, lack of permaculture, and also when they favor the commercial farmers in terms of resources, it's because we don't have permaculture experts at policy makers. We don't have permaculturists as members of parliament. So that's the thing that we need to address and see how we can be supported to make sure that we have representative in parliaments. And last, we have a problem of inequitable land allocation, and the rich land or fertile land goes usually to commercial farmers who are producing one type of crop for exportation. And sometimes they are growing food for biofuel. And whilst the people who are growing food for themselves, they cannot have good land. They live in a same type of soils. Why smallholder farmers or household farmers should exist? Directly, they contribute to food sovereignty. And that's our movement. We need food sovereignty, not food security. Particularly for the most vulnerable people. Climate change, food crisis, population increase, it's not an issue. Because if you understand permaculture properly, you apply permaculture properly, you can have a cushion, you can control, you can have climate change can be mitigated. Having direct immediate impact on hunger and poverty, traditional, they have mitigation means, like a day to wild fruits, wild insects. Like you all know what happened in Zimbabwe in 2008. There was the economy of Zimbabwe went down, and many people, they couldn't manage to have access to food, but they managed to be resilient we're using the natural resources or the resources that are within their own environment. With inadequate water supply, infertile land, limited inputs, they still produce diversity of food. And you go into a smallholder farmer, he doesn't produce maize only, because he knows very well maize cannot address the nutritional need of your family. They create food forest and that's resilient to natural and political challenges. They reduce carbon emission and sequestrate carbon in their own farms. The systems that they practice, you find traditionally, you'll see people in Kondwa ridges, they put trees. Around their homestead, they have fruit trees, they have shade trees, indigenous trees, for medicine, for bee forage, for a number of things. And all that is a means of sequestrating carbon. They are skilled and carry a vast livelihood experience. And waste is recycled within. You don't see plastics like what you see in urban areas. You don't see littering in the area. They have a good means of waste management, and they use everything that they have is recycled or used for something. They create hub of sustainable systems as nodes, and this is the message that I want to create, that together, when they come together, they create what they call a node. And a node is a system where different activities happen to support the food system and the livelihood system of the community. It includes number of things, renewable energy, water system, soil management. It is a pack and complex of permaculture in it. So what we are talking about, the household or smallholder farmer, they come together and they create a node. And for example, we have worked on these type of nodes. Like in Venda, we have a node that we actually created in South Africa, where we trained the community and they understand each other, they form themselves to a group, and they contribute towards one thing, and they grow food for themselves, and they bring in renewable energy in the community. But what is required there to form the nodes is to support them in organizing themselves. And also in Iswape, Zimbabwe, we are trying to make sure that we set the nodes as well. With the nodes, because the nodes are important in the existence of smallholder farmer, because they can share knowledge freely. They don't need to go to a school where they pay a lot of money, because children in the community, sometimes in rural areas, they don't have access of money to send children to university. But if they create nodes, the university is within the community. They share and supply without use of cash. And they protect culture and conserve biodiversity. And they practice their own rituals. And also to establish environmental stewardship within their own area, and create and secure livelihoods for large numbers of people, coordinate themselves to build education and health facilities, roads and education system. Like in Rusape, where I come from, the community, they managed to come together and they are building a school. They are actually done with three blocks, and they are busy now organizing to get water from a dam. Because what you find in most cases is that you find there is a dam in a community, like you find in Mozambique, there is Cabora Bassa. The electricity that is produced in Cabora Bassa is going to South Africa, but the people in Mozambique are not getting electricity. The water from Cabora Bassa goes into commercial farms. They are not getting water is not going to the people within. We have another example, Jozin Dam in South Africa, in KwaZulu-Natal. The water from the Jozin Dam goes far to commercial farmers, but the people within the area, they do not have access to it. Also, in my village in Zimbabwe, water from Rusape Dam has been going to Chisumbanje to irrigate sugar and cotton and other products there. But now we have said, no, we need the water in our village. So they've started putting up water, and we have an irrigation scheme that is coming through with the water that is from the dams there. But we want to put the water right into the homesteads so that people, they demonstrate the effectiveness of smallholder farmers. Once they have water, they can do it. The smallholder farmers can create and secure livelihoods for large numbers of people, coordinate themselves to build schools, improve local economy, produce local, sell local, and external food in communities, we don't need it. We need people to grow their own food. Create clusters of household farmers for establishing incubators. The incubator is a system that helps in supporting the nodes. The incubator, it's a hub of activities, mainly on how to manage sustainable communities. The people, they will need skills on project management. They will need skills on accounting. They will need skills on general administration. But you need an organization that is more lean to address that. An organization that is a lean organization that doesn't carry a lot of overheads. And then support cooperatives, cooperative movement. And create nodes, incubators of diverse permaculture practices. Access to land, water, and tools and technology of traditional sustainable farming. Organize a food sovereignty movement, address farmer rights. Because you know, in Africa, sometimes the farmers, they don't even know their rights. Do they have right to seed? Or they don't have? It's one thing that we have to address with them. And then we say yes to non-patent open pollinated seeds and access to local markets for selling our products and sharing our products. No to biofuel projects, genetically engineered seeds, and expensive chemical inputs. We say no to that. And Viva to create a new revolution of growing own food and a non-capitalistic economic system, a solidarity economic system for smallholder farmers and support their local economic system, their local markets. What are we saying here? We are saying that with the incubators, if they are there, we manage them, we administer them well, with good support, good governance, considering gender, and bring the business component into the whole system, clear communication, then we can be able to have markets and solidarity economy in our own community. We will make sure that the production, the food that we need is coming within. If we have one incubator in a town in Rusape or in a district, in a province, we'll make sure that we have another incubator in another province, so that they start sharing and exchange the products. So what are we saying? We need the future. What we need is how to get there. We need a paradigm shift. For political and policies, who represent us in the parliament? If there are organizations or countries or regions that are already having representative in their country in the parliament, we want to learn from that as well. And we, in education and training, we need a long-term permaculture qualification. Usually we have the attendance permaculture certificate, the PDC, the diploma. Of recent, there is with Gaya University, they are introducing the degree level. We need more degree university permaculture universities to supply, to run a degree level permaculture up to PhD. Because currently with the PDC certificate, it's not even known sometime in the mainstream education. So we need to make sure that we influence that we have a degree level that will compete or will work together with the other stream, the other with the academias. We need there is need of a paradigm shift that the International Permaculture Association usually it's like in from Africa, it's more international, it's more on the organized better in other countries, but in Zimbabwe or in Southern and Eastern Africa, we do need to have a good coordination system to set that. And we think we need support to set our association in Southern Africa. And smallholder farmers are not small, they are large, because they produce not only one crop, but diverse. Research, we need to make sure that there is a community-based technological and traditional research to link local economy system and effectiveness, to research on effectiveness of nodes and incubators, and research on permaculture production, productivity, and statistics contributing to GDP of every country. So sometimes we do not have statistics to compare that Monsanto is nothing. But we are good. This is the last slide. Hope I didn't take long. Okay, we also look to see the support in supporting women, as I indicated earlier. Once we empower the women, then we make our life easier, because they know everything, how to deal with that. And of course, the youth, so that they take over, we are getting old, they will need to take over, the youth need to take over what we are talking about. But we need to educate them in the right direction and make sure that we have internet link, we have an international link on how to address the training of the youth. We need to promote the informal, the network and exchange programs to change the paradigm shift. And what we are talking about is that we need to create a good network in Southern and Eastern Africa. Right now, we do not have a good network, and we do not have a good association in Southern and Eastern Africa. We need to have a formal and informal research. The formal is the academia. We work together with them for with farmer-based training. And also, we need to have ongoing farmer-to-farmer training, research, exchange programs, and mainly to address the issue of the economic of permaculture and the real management of our permaculture systems. And we also need research on international permaculture into all curriculums at all educational levels. We need to learn to those countries that are already linked with the Ministry of Education and they have good curriculum on permaculture. We want to learn from them and also need to make sure that we implement it in Africa. When we implement it in Africa, we have to make sure that the Southern and Eastern Africa it's on the map and be the champion in that node. And also in support on the infrastructure development of our nodes and the incubator systems and the structures to create and coordinate nodes and incubators for local economy system. Mainly we are talking about the excellence of permaculture, the administration part, and the project management, the research. It needs to be and be represented in the member of parliament, as a member of parliament, into government structures. And I thank you for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.